Hello and welcome to NewsClick. Today we are discussing the TSR Subramanian Committee report on the environment and what changes are sought to be made by the new government. We have with us D. Raghunandan of Delhi Science Forum and President of All India People Science Network, who has been working on the environmental issues for decades. Raghu, good to have you with us. What is the objective of the TSR Subramanian Committee report? Why was it set up and what are its broad directives?
Ostensibly, the committee was set up to review existing environmental legislations. The government being of the view that these have become cumbersome, that they are standing in the way of smooth implementation of developmental programs, and that they have lacked transparency in their implementation. This is the ostensible reason. However, the from the results of what we have seen from the committee's report, it seems to me to be an attempt to dismantle the existing environmental legislation and to create a structure to enable smooth passage of environmental clearances to new industries, with the idea of having quick setting up of new projects without the hurdles imposed by environmental regulations and so on, and to allow smooth passage for new projects and to allow smooth functioning of earlier projects without unnecessary hindrance from environmental regulation.
Raghu, nobody wants unnecessary hindrance. Nobody is opposed to smooth passage of things. Exactly. If everything is okay. So what is the holdup, or what used to be the holdup, and what does it really imply then?
Two things I think stand out. One is there were delays in evaluation of projects. There were problems in the way in which projects were evaluated. We all know that the experience with environmental impacts assessments has been far from satisfactory, with private consultants playing ducks and drakes with EIA reports. We know these problems earlier existed, and I would have been very happy to see a comprehensive review of these processes and the setting up of new systems with capability to do evaluations of new projects, quick environmental impact assessments, and then assessing these in order to grant or not grant environmental clearances. What this report does, however, is to say that because our systems earlier have not worked, in the future, let's not have systems at all. Everything has gone with it. And what the TSR committee has recommended essentially is to do away with these various cumbersome laws, either in terms of the laws themselves, by clubbing them in with an umbrella legislation, which would then make things easier, and to pass the buck to state governments. Now, again, in theory, this should be all right, that state government should have the prerogative to make an assessment and then to permit or not permit and regulate industries in their jurisdiction areas. The problem has been that central agencies, including the Ministry of Environment and Forest, the Central Pollution Control Board, and the state control boards, have had no capability either to do assessments or to do monitoring of industries. Idea should have been to strengthen the capacity of these agencies to do the job they were assigned to do.
Raghu, if you remember, Bhopal gas disaster was a basis for a lot of strengthening of the environmental impact assessment rules and so on. Exactly. What is hazardous, where it can be located, exactly, and so on. Isn't it somewhat ironical that 30 years, absolutely, after Bhopal, the biggest industrial disaster, absolutely, this is the 30th anniversary, absolutely, we are thinking of doing, absolutely, what really came as a consequence, absolutely, of that?
The Environment Protection Act itself was set up as a direct consequence of the Bhopal disaster and set up precisely in order to regulate hazardous industries, other industries, to set in motion a process of evaluation, assessment and monitoring. We all know that the weakest link in this was the monitoring of projects, which we know is an endemic problem in India anyway. We are good at passing laws and then take no measures to enforce their implementation or to monitor them. And this is happening sector after sector, and the environment is no exception. But I think the TSR committee's biggest disservice has been that, having been set up to review the legislations and having been given the great time of 2 months to review all legislations and then come out with a comprehensive review, just took an additional 1 month and in 3 months' time has come out with this report, which funnily enough contains no review at all. I think the methodology has been exactly what you suggested. Is you knew what you wanted to do, which is you wanted a loose framework in which industries would or project holders would call the shots. There would be no unnecessary interference with their work, no hurdles put on them, and they could then go about merrily doing whatever they wanted. To me, clearly, the set of recommendations that have come out from here will precisely mean that.
So, protection of the environment is no longer a part of the government's agenda, except to be lip service to it. It's a substantive part of what you say. You also had, you haven't talked about the composition of the people who were doing this.
Yes.
Did it contain any environmental experts known for the knowledge of the Environmental Act, etc., etc.?
I may be prejudiced, but I'll have to say no. In the sense that one has seen over the last two decades a large number of experts in environment and industry. It's not just environmentalists or tree huggers, as they are called, but people who do look at both environment and development. One doesn't see in this committee any of these people. You've got former secretaries of the government, and acting as a secretary to this committee is secretary of the Gujarat State Pollution Control Board, who has actually virtually presided over the dismantling of all environmental monitoring and permission and regulation in the state of Gujarat. The industrial belt around Vapi is today notorious for being one of the most polluted areas of this country, where industries are happily discharging liquid effluents. These are mostly chemical industries, since we are talking about it in the context of Bhopal, who are discharging all kinds of noxious fumes through their chimneys.
Last question, that what would this mean? Would it mean a change of laws? Would the parliament also have to be taken into confidence on this? Or is it only executive action which is envisaged?
This will definitely mean legislative action, because this will mean major changes in 5 major environmental laws: the Environment Pollution Act, the Water Act, the Air Act. It will involve these.
Environment Protection
Act. Environment Protection Act. And it also involves, one of the key recommendations of this committee is the reduction of powers of the National Green Tribunal, of the NGT. And it has specifically now said that decisions taken by district level environment courts, which are going to be set up, are not subject to review by judicial bodies, except on matters of procedure, not on the merits of the case, which is precisely what the National Green Tribunal was set up for. Because if it's just a review on procedural matters, the High Court is already there to deal with it and could have dealt with it in any case. So now it will mean that decisions taken at lower levels cannot be subject to judicial review. So not only have you done away with good legislation to protect the environment, you have weakened the enforcement and monitoring mechanisms, you've also done away with judicial review.
Because this has been the demand of big business.
Absolutely.
And particularly Absolutely. Global as well as Indian big business.
Absolutely.
And therefore, this possibility of alliance, as it were, between big business, local, regional governments and the central government really exists. And Congress is an unknown quantity on this, because even the Manmohan government, there are a lot of opinions that this is holding up development, etc., etc. So we need to see what the people really say on this, on the 30th year of the Bhopal disaster, whether we have still memories of that, what led to it, and what we need to protect if we don't want more Bhopals. Thank you very much, Raghu, to have you with us. We'll monitor what happens on this very sensitive area in the future. Thank you.